Hi folks! Up until now, the unaxial tensile testing at video number 2.1, toughness concepts at video number 2.2, and hardness tests at video number 2.3 were covered. In this video, 3 and 4 point bending tests will be put under the spotlight. Let's start! Tensile testing offers an immense amount of information on the materials' stress-strain behaviors under unaxial loading. Yet, utilization of unaxial tensile testing for collection of reliable and accurate data may become quite hard for brittle materials, since the preparation of the dog bone specimens for them is not as easy as it is for other materials. Also, the dog bone specimens are squeezed by the grips to make sure that they do not slide during unaxial tensile loading. However, the stress applied by the grip to the specimen may damage the brittle materials even before the loading starts, and may lead to the fracture from the grips. Lastly, the misalignment of the grips in tensile testing can be tolerable for ductile materials, yet it can lead to premature fracturing of brittle materials due to the formation of complex stress states that will be introduced for those conditions. So, to overcome these problems and to enable the collection of accurate and repeatable data and easy stress-strain analysis of brittle materials, 3 and 4 point bending tests were developed. Rod specimens having circular or rectangular cross-sections are employed for bending tests. Compared to the dog bone specimens used for unaxial tensile testing, the specimen geometry needed for 3 and 4 point bending tests are quite simple and much easier to prepare. A rod specimen with a circular or a rectangular cross-section is used for 3 and 4 point bending testing. For this purpose, a standardized specimen is mounted on two supporting pins of the universal tensile testing setup with bending test apparatus installed. During loading in 3-point bending tests, the centrally aligned loading pin starts moving down in the Z- direction towards the specimen at a constant strain rate. As the pin keeps moving, the specimen starts to bend elastically, as a result of which, the top surface of the specimen experiences compression, and the lower surface of the specimen experiences tension, leading to a complex stress formation over the specimen. Meanwhile, the middle section experiences neither compression nor tension and is called neutral zone. Since the application of the load is different from and more complex than that of the tensile testing, the stress calculations are different for bending tests. The flexural stress is equal to sigma equals m times c divided by I. Here, M stands for the maximum bending moment. C stands for the distance from the center of the specimen to the outer surface of the specimen. And I stands for the moment of inertia of the specimen's cross-section. For specimens having rectangular cross-sectional area, M is equal to F times L divided by 4, where F is equal to the applied force in newtons, L is equal to the distance between the supporting pins in millimeters, C is equal to D over 2, where D is equal to the thickness of the rectangular sample in Z-axis in millimeters, and I is equal to B times D to the third power divided by 12, where B is equal to the width of the specimen in millimeters. The resulting flexural stress for rectangular specimens is equal to 3 times F times L divided by 2 times B times D to the second power. The stress value calculated from the fracture point is called the flexural strength, which is a material property and is reported in megapascal. Same as in stress calculations, strain calculations for 3-point bending tests are different from tensile testing. And for a rectangular specimen, flexural strain is equal to 6 times capital D times small case d divided by L square, where capital D is equal to the maximum deflection of the center of the specimen in millimeters. The strain value calculated from the fracture point is called the flexural strain, which is a material property and is reported in percentage. As you may recall from video number 2.1, in the elastic region of stress strain curve, sigma was equal to the multiplication of strain with Young's modulus. As this equation is rearranged, Young's modulus ends up being equal to stress divided by strain. A similar correlation is valid for flexural stress, flexural strain, and flexural modulus, which is flexural stress is equal to flexural strain times flexural modulus. Using this relation, the flexural modulus equation is found to be equal to flexural stress divided by flexural strain. And that is equal to L to the third power times M divided by 4 times B times D to the third power, where M is equal to F divided by capital D for specimens having rectangular cross-sectional area. Before we wrap up this video, we will take a brief look at the 4-point bending test. During the 4-point bending test, the load is applied via two pins equidistant from the center of the specimen. Having two pins for loading enables us to overcome the shear forces that was observed in between the supporting pins for 3-point bending test. Therefore, when testing very brittle materials or laminated composites, which cannot withstand the shear stresses much, the 4-point bending tests will be a better alternative as it prevents the shear loading of the specimen. Depending on the positioning of the loading pins, the resulting stress equation slightly changes. For 3-point bending test, the stress was equal to 3 times F times L divided by 2 times B times D to the second power. At 4-point bending test, when the distance between the loading pins is equal to 1/3 of the distance between supporting pins, flexural stress equation is equal to F times L divided by B times D to the second power. And when the distance between the loading pins is 1/2 of the distance between the supporting pins, then the resulting flexural stress equation is equal to 3 times F times L divided by 4 times B times D to the second power. Lastly, here are some of the standards for 3 and 4 point bending tests. With this said, we have reached the end of this video. In this video, 3 and 4 point bending tests were covered. In the upcoming video number 2.5, we will make an introduction to fatigue testing. See you on the next one!